My goodness gracious.
Yo, this is crazy.
Oh my God.
This is lit. What's going on, everybody? Welcome to a very, very, very special episode of Fung Bros Food.
And we've eaten a lot of grilled food in our lives, but we have never grilled an entire feast on rocks. And before we embark on this crazy stone grill journey, you know we could not do this without a Harvard graduate and stand-up comedian friend, Sierra Cattow.
Hi, I'm Sierra Cattow. I'm a stand-up comedian and a writer, and I'm here, I'm ready to eat.
Oh, it's Cattow.
Cattow.
You were calling it Cattow. Oh my goodness.
I'm so used to it that I didn't even notice.
Cattow's Japanese because your dad's Japanese.
Oh, man.
Because your dad's Japanese and your mom's Chinese.
I'm so rude. I've been up here for what, like a minute already? I haven't even told you what kind of Asian I am. Oh my God. Sorry.
The Chinese part of me is always like, oh, Sierra, find a nice Chinese boy to date. And then the Japanese part of me is like, no, find a nice Japanese boy to date. Right? And then the American part of me is like, I don't know, they're all yellow to me. Like, just pick one. Like,
have you ever eaten food off a stone grill?
I've had fajitas.
It's heated up to like 400 degrees. We're gonna be grilling a whole bunch of food and I'm hungry, man.
This is a crazy concept, only in the 626.
Let's go. Like how they hit you with the unusual imagery for like a restaurant.
Really creepy, but also there's like a Halloween thing going on.
So there's some like club vibes.
Yeah.
Kind of like some freaky, geeky club vibes though. You heard the owner did this mural himself.
This is Sky the owner, man. He did the painting up there.
Yeah.
This is an Asian fusion spot designed for Asian people.
Get our own stuff.
We have our first round of appetizers. This is a fruit salad that has shrimp. It's interesting, right?
I mean, why not add it on top? I love shrimp. I feel like it's got kind of a fruity look to it.
That is not a regular salad that you're gonna get at, you know, lemonade or something like that.
I'm just glad there's like a lot of mayonnaise because that actually just kind of makes it good.
Duck pate egg rolls. They actually captured the essence of Peking duck inside of a spring roll. These are Hong Kong fish livers.
Not Hong Kong.
Oh, yeah.
Hong
what
Kong.
That mean?
I think Hong Kong's a type of fish, and that is its liver.
That was cool to have that, you know?
Yeah, I'm not gonna lie. For two very smart people, you guys are at a lot
cool
of
to
words.
Have that. Yeah, well, you know, it's
had a really nice sweet burst, and it was interesting.
Yeah.
You think you can get that at a boba shop, but it's actually rose petal flavored popcorn chicken.
What?
Rose petal. So this is basically fancy fried chicken. Rose glazed chicken in rose syrup.
But it's good though, actually. This is good. It's a good different. It tastes a little bit like chicken and waffles.
Yeah.
I'm thinking they didn't have a lot of this stuff on the menu anywhere near Harvard Square.
Not really, no.
Everything looks like Grimm's fairy tale. Very gargoyles
on it.
A lot of peacoats and books.
A lot of privilege.
A lot of
So you were kind of like, you were kind of like a fish out of water at Harvard?
A little bit. It looks like there's a range of folks, so I always found my people.
We're not fitting in with the Kavanaughs of
Harvard.
What style would you say your humor is?
Kind of dry, talk about personal stuff, try to stick to your own life.
What?
Material.
What'd you major in at Harvard?
Computer science.
Okay, computer
science.
Wow. Yeah, so.
Which is usually what Harvard comedians major in.
This is true.
A lot of actually comedians do come out of Harvard. That is one thing I realized.
Yeah.
A lot of specifically writers.
Writers for
not as much performers, but still some performers. Conan O'Brien.
Yes, a lot of TV writers, because a lot from Lampoon, a lot from other theaters.
Alan Yang.
Alan Yang, yeah.
What do you have advice for people who are like, who are watching, who want to get in?
Hey, I sent in a stand-up video. It wasn't that funny.
This is the crab spinach soup.
Actually, this is really good. It's crazy how it looks. It almost looks like sea kelp or something. Like almost like, wow. Algae?
It has this spinach crab bisque flavor. Oh my goodness gracious.
Yo, this is crazy.
Oh my God.
This is lit. Yo, you guys, these are lava stone grills.
And they are burning right now for the next 45 minutes. They are gonna be 400 degrees, so we cannot touch it.
They refer to that as steam, it's not smoke. Right here on the FAQ, it is steam. What is perceived in reference as smoke is predominantly moisture steam released when a moist, uncooked product is initially seared on the heated stone.
It's probably not the steam you want to steam your pores with.
That stone is 400 degrees Celsius.
That's hot. What?
So calculate in your mind, Harvard. How many Fahrenheits is 400 degrees Celsius.
Sorry, Harvard doesn't teach us this.
Okay, more of a Yale thing. 725 Fahrenheit. So they got black pepper and ponzu, and these are both house-made sauces.
So these lava stones stay hot for up to 4 hours, but obviously the first 45 minutes to an hour is the hottest. So that's when you want to cook all your food.
So we have a ribeye.
This is a fat piece of ribeye. Should we flip it now?
Yes, absolutely. So as soon as you guys get it, we flip it. Stealing all the juices on the side.
I see what you did there on the side.
We use a very USDA choice prime steak. We don't want to ruin the steak itself. You know, we want all the juices, all the bombness on the hot stone. Let it do all the talking, stealing all the juices.
Yo, I learned something. I did not know that you sear the side to lock in the juices, because all the juices will flow out the side.
I learned that from Gordon Ramsay, actually.
Guys, if it's a really good cut of steak, all you need is a little salt, maybe no salt at all, you know? I am curious to see how the stone grill ribeye compares to regular grilled ribeye.
Wow, that's really good. It definitely is like, you can really taste the meat flavor.
Mm.
The ponzu is really light. Obviously some of the acidity, it cuts through.
Yeah.
So at a lot of Hong Kong cafes, you can actually get a steak with black pepper sauce. So this is like the elevated version.
You don't really taste too much char, I feel like, because it's not an open flame.
That's a good point. It's very crispy, but it's not burnt.
It's a little bit more advanced than Korean barbecue, though, for sure. You gotta stay on top of it more.
And you know what's interesting, comparing it to Korean barbecue? One, you got a hot stone. Two, it's actually a much smaller area that you're working with. So you're actually making all these little intricate movements, so you gotta be a little bit more on point.
We've got some lamb chops.
You've made it through Harvard's computer science engineering school. You can make it through this.
Wow. Sorry, that was really good.
That is dripping. This is fire, guys.
The lamb.
I'm gonna dip it in the ponds.
Oh my goodness, the lamb was incredible.
Yo, Sierra, great job with the lamb.
Oh, hey, anytime.
That was your grill. I gotta give it to you. You were in charge.
We've got what very much appears to be an octopus tentacle.
Yeah, that is a fat tentacle, man.
Yes, it is.
Oh, so that's raw.
Yeah.
And we're gonna cook it.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yo.
That's really good. Well, I'm gonna have some of the scallops. Yo, the scallop is really good.
Scallops is one of those things you don't want to sauce a lot.
Gigantic shrimp, they almost look like slim pineapples.
That's like, yeah. Like pineapple spears.
Yes.
Oh, that was a killer prawn. That prawn was actually cooked perfectly.
Yeah, wow, that's crazy. That's
it's a little salty too. Ooh.
What, like it's...
Whoa. No, that was really good. Holy crap. That has a really, really nice saltwater flavor to it.
So this spot, Scala, is the only one that has the license to the brand name Stone Grill, and they come from Australia. So right now, at this moment in America, this is the only spot where you can get the lava stone grill. Alhambra leading the way. Okay, starting off round three, we have the cone fried rice, but it is smoked duck and sweet melon fried rice, something I've never had before, in the shape of a cone. How did they engineer this, engineer?
Grain by grain.
That seems efficient. It really balances out with the smoked duck. Smoked duck comes in, but then you have this burst of citrus freshness that's coming in from the melon. It's pretty awesome.
Reminds me of like breakfast. It's like sometimes you get your fruit salad and you're savory.
Guys, now we have the orange cointreau short rib. Cointreau is a liquor. It's cooked for hours. Short rib, boom. This is your femur.
That's really good. That is falling apart.
I really like that a lot, man. That liquor like makes it a little bit sweet. So it's a sweet short rib, but it has like that burst of fruitiness, like almost like the fried rice, how that had the burst of fruitiness too.
It was light, but it still felt decadent due to the meat. You know, the meat is obviously very fatty.
The name, I thought it was gonna be like overly orange, but I feel like it's the right amount.
Who are some of your like favorite stand-ups right now?
Tiffany Haddish, Ali Wong, that's so exciting. That I think her Netflix special is like one of the most popular, that it's like an Asian woman is an extra bonus, but she's just hilarious. Margaret Cho, obviously. Awkwafina's, like, I've always been a fan of her music. It also helps when they're kind of like look like you a little bit and you're like, okay.
Yeah, they're like,
then people are receptive to that kind of person, then I could do it.
This is mango chicken pasta.
Mango and a pasta.
Mango and chicken all in a pasta?
Yo.
And mango.
That mango smell is strong, bro.
Oh,
like,
yeah.
they didn't just chop up the mangoes and just throw them in there. They
cooked it with that.
Yeah.
Oh, man. I've never had anything like that before.
See, this is one of the most unique restaurants I've been to in a long time. Each one of your guys' reaction was, whoa, whoa.
It's like something in a way you think it wouldn't work, but it totally works.
Smells so sweet, and then it's still savory.
Yo, I love how they're able to fuse like a lot of fruit flavors into a lot of these dishes. Mm-hmm. If you guys like Hong Kong food, trust me, this is like
straight up gumbo,
next level.
Kowloon side, yeah, too. Yeah. This is Thai soft shell crab. Cone rice, but with a egg crepe on top.
Yo, I've never seen that egg crepe on rice before, Whoa. Actually. What are these? This is actually a string of fresh peppercorns. Ooh, this soft shell crab is intact. I like that. Look at that.
Oh, very light. I can tell that that is a Hong Kong interpretation versus obviously, you know, authentic Thai style would be Muay Thai kicking me in the face so hard. So I can tell, you know, more muted and sort of to fit like the Cantonese palate.
Definitely.
Oh man, it's just been a whirlwind of flavors in my mind. I'm like, do you have a better chance getting rich doing comedy or doing computer science?
Well, definitely computer science. I mean, you make more money doing that. That's, if it's just about money, then yes, computer science.
But I don't know any computer science workers who made as much as Ali Wong did last year.
There you go.
When you tell other Asians or Asian parents that you graduated from Harvard, what is their reaction? Especially out here in California, not as many Harvard grads. And they're like, oh my gosh, I have a son.
Yeah, I mean, well, the Asian folks are definitely like way more excited about it, I think. Everyone else is kind of like, all right, simmer down, shut, we don't want to know. We don't care.
In the American culture, it almost being like bad to say you're from Harvard. Because it's almost
you
like-
You want to stay humble, right?
Because, you know what it is? Yeah. They don't like anything that jeopardizes the flat social class system they've been trying to push in America for 200 years. In Asia, first of all, they are not interested in a flat social system, and you are the shit.
If you ever feel like the conversation's dead and you're just like,
what's Harvard?
I gotta say something, I said, so I graduated from Harvard.
Oh, God.
Oh,
oh,
my.
Oh, wow, yeah,
goodness.
No, never, don't let me ever
are
do that.
A good person.
You've traveled and toured around America already being a stand-up. What are some of the funnier or more ridiculous comments you've gotten in person?
Recently, I mean, there was a crowd and they're basically all white in Wisconsin and they're very, very sweet. They were like very drawn to the idea, like, oh wow, you know, an Asian American comedian. So they were trying to relate. So I think after the show, they talked a little bit about ginseng. They were like, oh, there's a lot of like ginseng root that they harvest around Wisconsin. I was like, oh, I mean, I've had Arizona iced tea, like, no. But it's, but like, okay, yeah.
Right, they were trying to relate to you by bringing up the ginseng root that they
farmed.
That's a positive interaction.
Yeah, that's
pretty funny. What do you think are the biggest issues with, like, why it's taken so long for Asians to break through?
A lot of, like, in mainstream entertainment stuff, there's a lot of gatekeepers, and I think, like, the fact that they're finally able to take a chance and, like, diversity's hot right now, and so Asians are hot right now, like, maybe it did take sort of, like, a bunch of movements all at once to finally have everything collide perfectly.
You are half Japanese and half Chinese.
I am.
How do you negotiate that? Because those two sides generally do not historically like each other.
Well, I mean, a lot of the work was done because my parents are married each other. They're pretty far removed from like any sort of issues there. Yeah. Like they're both third generation. Of course, they want me to learn about our family history and like certain things that are Chinese American history, Japanese American history. But as far as like animosity, we've left it in the past. There's still like the idea that there's a little bit of, oh, well, you know, maybe I should have learned more of one or the other, and then maybe my mom wants to take me to Chinatown, my dad wants to take me to Little Tokyo more often. Then there's maybe a little bit more like, oh, this side's more interesting, this side's more interesting, which one do you identify with more? And then at the end of the day, I'm like, I don't know. I just become more like, ah, what is race?
Okay.
You know?
You're fourth generation.
Yeah, yeah.
Are you considered whitewashed or you grew up around a lot of Asian Americans?
Yeah, yeah. I think I'm like very Asian American, like, grew up around a lot of Asian Americans in Southern California. There's like, I actually grew up around a lot of like Korean Americans. I would say, yeah, I'm probably very whitewashed compared to a lot of people. I kind of like that, you know, there's sort of this in between. It's like, well, I'm not white, obviously. I'm not Asian.
Are you basically saying the future of Asian America is Sierra Kato?
It's from David put it out himself.
As somebody who creates, but you easily could have been like a high paid analyzer. How did you develop that production mindset?
Trying to figure out, yeah, maybe the things that are lacking that are already out there. And I think as Asian Americans, we're already in that position. So it's like also being a little bit, when we talk about bragging, it's like being a little bit self-important where you're like, ooh, my story might actually be interesting to somebody besides myself. And that takes a lot of guts to actually get to that point, and it's scary. But like, then when you write something and you're like, okay, I guess I have to have the guts to then go out there and try to sell it or try to like say it on stage. That's like so rewarding when somebody responds to that, whether it's negative or positive.
You have to believe your story is worth hearing.
Yeah.
And some people are right and some people are wrong. Mm-hmm.
What are your upcoming projects?
I'm always doing stand-up, so if you go to my website, sierracotto.com, I have my tour dates there. I'm on Instagram at sierracotto and on Twitter at sierracotto if you want to follow what I do.
Yo, that was a great feast at Scala Stone Grill. We were eating off of a 700-degree lava rock, grilling octopus tentacles and soft shell crabs and prawns and lamb, eating like fruit fried rice and pasta. And you guys got to check out this spot because this is an extremely unique restaurant with an extremely unique person, Sierra Cato. Okay. Everybody, thank you so much for watching that video, and definitely give this video a big thumbs up, subscribe to our channel. Write in the comments below, let us know what other cool people you would like to see us eat some very interesting food with. All right, everybody, we're out in the 626, and until next time, we out. Peace.
Ellen Yang.
Wait, mm-hmm. Do you know him?
I'm not like best buds. Yeah, most of the time I know, just Alan. Congratulations on all your success.
Bow away.
Like, oh, it's so nice to meet you.
The Asian who has made it. Yeah.